The instrument landing system is a precision radio navigation aid that guides aircraft to a runway even in very poor weather. It provides continuous lateral and vertical guidance along the final approach path, allowing pilots to land safely at night or in low visibility. By using two intersecting radio beams, ILS dramatically expands the range of conditions under which a landing can be made. In essence, ILS turns blind landing approaches into nearly visual landings by telling the pilot exactly how to line up and descend on the runway centerline. Let's start with, what is the ILS? The ILS is formally defined as a precision runway approach aid based on two radio beams providing horizontal and vertical guidance. In practice, the system consists of a localizer transmitter located at the far end of the runway and a GlideSlope transmitter near the approach threshold. The localizer broadcasts between 108 and 112 MHz and projects two overlapping beams, one to the left and one to the right of centerline. When the aircraft's receiver sees equal signals from both, the aircraft is exactly on runway centerline. Simultaneously, the GlideSlope antenna between 329 and 335 MHz transmits two intersecting beams above and below the desired 3-degree descent path. When the aircraft's receiver indicators center on the GlideSlope, the airplane is on the correct descent angle. Together, these signals allow the pilot to track a stable 3-degree approach path to the runway. Why ILS is preferred in low visibility. Pilots favor ILS approaches in instrument meteorological conditions because they provide the most precise guidance of any landing aid. Unlike non-precision aids, which give only lateral guidance, ILS is combined vertical and horizontal information lets an aircraft descend continuously on a defined glide slope. This means the aircraft can be safely brought to very low altitudes with low flight visibility. For example, a standard Category 1 allows a pilot to descend to about 200 feet above the runway with only 550 meters runway visual range. At that point, the runway environment must be visible, or a go-around is initiated. Higher ILS categories allow even lower landing minimums. In practice, ILS revolutionized aviation by enabling approaches in near-zero ceilings. Pilots routinely make ILS landings when it seems they can't see anything all the way to the ground. By contrast, non-precision approaches often require higher minimum altitudes and steeper descent steps, increasing pilot workload and risk in bad weather. Localizer and GlideSlope working principle. ILS relies on two independent antennas, the localizer for lateral alignment and the GlideSlope for vertical descent. Localizer is located at the end of the runway. The localizer transmits two narrow VHF beams, one modulated at 90 Hz, projected slightly to the right of runway centerline, and another, modulated at 150 Hz, projected slightly to the left. Where those beams overlap defines the runway centerline. In the cockpit, the course deviation indicator shows the needle centered if the aircraft is on the localizer. If the needle deflects, the pilot flies toward the needle to recapture centerline. This provides precise azimuth guidance even from many miles out. GlideSlope is the antenna placed beside the runway, near the threshold, and emits two overlapping UHF beams, one above and one below the ideal descent path, typically set for a 3-degree angle. The beams overlap at the correct approach angle. As the aircraft approaches, the GlideSlope indicator moves off center if above or below the GlideSlope. The pilot adjusts pitch to fly down the center of the GlideSlope beams. This ensures a stable descent angle and a safe runway threshold crossing height. As the aircraft nears the runway, the localizer and GlideSlope signals become more sensitive, requiring finer control inputs. Pilots are trained to make small, smooth corrections rather than chase the needles to ensure a stable descent. Marker beacons. Marker beacons provide distance information on an ILS approach. Traditionally, up to three marker beacons may be on the final approach path, each identified by a unique tone and cockpit light. Outer marker is usually about 4 to 7 nautical miles from the runway. It flashes blue and indicates the final approach fix where the GlideSlope is intercepted on a Category 1 ILS. Middle marker is around 0.5 to 1 nautical mile from the threshold, roughly at decision height. It flashes amber and alerts the pilot that they are passing the decision height or altitude. Inner marker is used on Category 2 approaches. It flashes white and indicates the point of DH on those lower category approaches. each marker beacon is accompanied by an indicator and tone in the cockpit. In modern airfields, outer and middle markers are being replaced by DME or GPS fixes, but pilots still learn marker definitions as backup cues. Decision altitude. The decision altitude or decision height is a critical part of any ILS approach. It is the altitude, above runway threshold elevation, at which the pilot must decide to continue landing or go around. On an ILS approach, the aircraft follows the glide slope until reaching the DH. At that point, the flight crew must have the required visual references of the runway environment. If not, a missed approach is initiated immediately. In formal terms, when the DH is reached, the approach may only be continued if the specified visual reference is available. Otherwise, a go-around must be flown. In practice, pilots brief the exact decision altitude for their category of ILS and call out height steadily so that everyone is ready to see the runway by DH. Approach lighting system. ILS runways usually have an approach lighting system that aids the transition from instrument flight to visual landing. The ALS is an array of high-intensity lights extending outward from the runway threshold along the extended center line. It provides runway alignment cues, height perception, and distance-to-go references in low visibility. Typically, the lights start at the threshold and extend several hundred meters into the approach zone. Different ALS configurations exist. For example, a simple ALS might be a single bar with a crossbar, whereas a full Category 1, 2, and 3 ALS has multiple sequenced flashing lights and several transverse bars. The key point is that seeing the approach lights gives the pilot the necessary visual references to continue from instruments to touchdown. An ILS approach can only be continued below decision height when the runway, usually the approach lighting system or runway lights, is visible. ILS approaches are grouped into categories: Category 1, 2, 3 Alpha, 3 Bravo, and 3 Charlie. That specify how low they can go. The higher the category, the lower the minimums. First category is Category 1. Category 1 approaches decision height not lower than 200 feet and runway visual range not less than 550 meters. This is the standard approach for most airports. Category 2, decision height not lower than 100 feet and RVR not less than 350 meters. Requires extra equipment and training. Category 3, Alpha. Decision height is lower than 100 feet, or no DH, and RVR not less than 200 meters. Approaches down to 50 feet are possible. Category 3, Bravo. Decision height is lower than 50 feet, or no DH, and RVR not less than 50 meters. In practice, aircrafts can land in very low visibility. Category 3, Charlie approach, has no decision height or RVR limit, full autoland capability. Very few airports or aircraft support Category 3, Charlie routinely. Above Category 1, operations, special ground equipment, redundancy, and pilot.aircraft certification are required. For example, Category 2 and 3 runways have more sensitive monitors and backup power to ensure signal integrity. These enhanced ILS categories let airlines land safely in fog that would ground all Category 1 traffic. ILS Approach Chart. An ILS instrument approach chart graphically presents everything needed for the procedure. Key elements include identification and frequencies, the chart name, the ILS frequency and Morse ID, and the inbound course to dial in. Plan view, a top-down diagram showing the final approach course, locally aligned with runway centerline, the ILS critical area, any feeder fixes or holds, and missed approach waypoints. Profile view, a side view of the approach showing altitude and distance. The final approach fix is marked. For ILS, it's shown by a lightning bolt symbol. From the final approach fix downward, the glide slope descent path is drawn, along with checkpoint altitudes. The decision altitude is indicated on this view. From that point to the runway, the line typically switches to a dashed missed approach profile. Minimum section lists the decision altitude and required visibility for each category of aircraft approach speed. For a precision ILS, the DA is the limiting factor. If the pilot reaches DA and does not see the runway or required lights, the chart says to go missed. For example, on an ILS chart, you'll see the inbound course is 058, the final approach fix symbol, the glide slope angle, the altitude at the FAF, and the decision altitude. The missed approach instructions, climb out heading, or holds are also printed. In this chart, if some reason you go around, misses approach procedure is climb 4,000 feet to Foxtrot Juliet 050 on course 058, then turn left, proceed ESAR and hold. Pilots brief the plate before flying the approach. If you want to watch how to brief an approach detailed, you can watch my full briefing video. Let's continue with difference between precision and non-precision approaches. ILS is a precision approach, meaning it provides both lateral and vertical guidance. By contrast, non-precision approaches, such as VOR, NDB, or localizer-only approaches, provide only lateral guidance. Vertical guidance, GlideSlope, is absent. On a non-precision approach, the pilot must descend to a specified minimum descent altitude MDA and maintain it without a GlideSlope, using step-down fixes or timing. This lack of vertical guidance makes non-precision approaches less precise and generally more demanding in bad weather. The ILS approach's precision makes it inherently safer in low visibility conditions. Indeed, a high proportion of approach-related accidents occur on non-precision approaches where pilots descend without exact GlideSlope information. Last thing you should know about ILS is the common errors and considerations. Even though ILS is straightforward to fly, pilots must watch for certain pitfalls. False GlideSlope indication. If an aircraft intercepts the GlideSlope from too far out or at too steep an angle, it can lock onto a false lobe above the true GlideSlope, typically multiples of 3 degrees, 9 degrees, 15 degrees. This can lead to an unintended high descent angle. In mountainous or long approaches, pilots can inadvertently capture a false GS, leading to unstable flight path and potential go-around. To avoid this, crews cross-check altitude and distance when capturing the GlideSlope. Wrong course or frequency. Setting the wrong localizer frequency or inbound course will obviously mislead the aircraft and the CD. I won't center on the runway correctly. Pilots must identify the ILS Morse code to ensure the correct station is tuned. Poor instrument scan. Once established, the ILS signals become very sensitive. Over-controlling, chasing the localizer or GlideSlope needles aggressively, can induce oscillations. Conversely, ignoring small deviations can result in full-scale needle deflection. Good IFR technique demands a smooth cross-checked scan. Do not chase the needle. Use small corrections based on the localizer and GlideSlope errors. If the needle moves beyond half-scale, the approach is considered out of bounds, and a missed approach is required. By being aware of these issues and adhering to procedures like stabilized approach criteria, pilots safely fly ILS approaches routinely. And that wraps up our deep dive into the instrument landing system. As one of the most precise and reliable navigation aids in aviation, it plays a critical role in guiding aircraft safely down to the runway, especially in poor visibility. Remember, understanding how the localizer, GlideSlope, and marker beacons work together gives you the confidence to perform instrument approaches accurately and safely. Whether you're preparing for your instrument rating or just expanding your aviation knowledge, mastering the ILS is a must for every pilot. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to like, subscribe, and share for more flight training videos and aviation insights. Fly safe, and I'll see you in the next lesson. Goodbye.